seven steps that God uses to take us through, and these kind of follow along with the teaching, or they do follow along with the teaching in the book of Romans. Okay, and so God desires to bring us to a place of service in our lives. And we saw in verse 1 that Paul stated not only that he was an apostle, but he considered himself a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we shared about an Old Testament portion of scripture where if a servant or a slave wanted to remain with their master, okay, in the seventh year, that they could have their ear nailed to a pole, okay, a hole put in their ear, and they would be marked as one who loved their master and wanted to stay with them. And Paul was letting us know, and we are this way too, you know, we should be this way also, that he wanted to be a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he wanted to do what the Lord wanted him to do. And we shared some scripture, 1 Corinthians 6:20, for you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's. Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Okay, so we are bought by God. God has paid a price for you and I. And that's a wonderful thing. We are a possession of God. Amen? Amen. We belong to God. And that's not, you know, something that is derogatory or something that is demeaning. I mean, who else, what greater person could we belong to than the Lord Jesus Christ? Amen? And we're thankful for that. We went on, and verses 2 through 4, we saw that this gospel was prophesied about in the scriptures. Jesus was prophesied to be the son of David, the son of God. And remember, we're dealing with Jews and Romans, okay? With the power of God to back that up. The ultimate declaration or proof of that power is when he was raised from the dead by the Holy Spirit. All of this was foretold. It wasn't something that the Jews should not have known about. They should have known about it. Okay, we could look at different portions of scripture. We could go to the Psalms and we could speak there how that Jesus is the son of David. He said, I made a covenant with my chosen. I have sworn unto David, my servant, thy seed will I establish forever and build upon thy throne to all generations, Selah. Psalm 132:11, the Lord has sworn in truth unto David, he will not turn from it. Of the fruit of thy body will I set upon thy throne. Okay, Isaiah 11:1, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. All of these things were prophesied about the Lord and about how that he would come through that lineage of David. And we go on and we see his sonship. Psalm 2:7, I will declare the decree. The Lord hath sworn, said unto me, excuse me, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Psalm 16:10, for thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thy holy one to see corruption. The prophecy of him being raised from the dead. A lot of other things that we could look to, but if you want more information about that, we have a Bible teaching on messianic prophecy, several, okay, in our list there on YouTube, and you can go there and learn more about the messianic prophecies, okay? So we're going to go now into verse 5. We left off in verse 4. We're going to go into verse 5 now, and we continue on, and if you have your little outline sheet here, okay, we're still in our introduction, okay, through verse 17, but in verse 5, the Apostle Paul states, by whom, okay, by the Son of God, we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. So it's by Christ that we have received grace and apostleship, and all the gifts and the callings of God are by him. They're made possible because of him. Yes. Because of him, we have sonship. Yes. Okay, because of him, we are children of God. Because of him, we are joint heirs. Yes. Okay, men and women. Okay, and because we're joint heirs, because of him, all of these things are made available to us because of what he did. Okay, so every one of us, though we may not be an apostle, okay, we are all called to be a witness for the Lord and to by our faith, show men and women Christ to lift him up. As he said, if I, even I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Well, we are to lift him up in our lives for his glory. Okay, all that we do, okay, should be for his glory. And you know, we too can be like the Apostle Paul, as we've already shared about him, being a servant of the Lord. That's really what the word minister means. You know, we have some here that are on their way, Lord willing, pretty soon, you know, when they get out to seminary, you're going to go into the ministry. That word means you're going to be a servant. Okay, that's what you're going to do. That's what the word means. And we're to do that for the glory of the Lord, just like the Apostle Paul, just like others that we learn of in the Bible, and especially our greatest example, just like Jesus. Okay, so Ephesians 4 and 11, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for what? For the perfecting of the saints, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Amen? Amen. That's what we are to do. And now, as we said, some of you are wanting to go into the ministry. God has called you. God is the one that has put that in your heart. And maybe you think, well, Pastor, you're kind of being a little bit more strict on me. And you're kind of being a little bit, you know, more serious with me. Well, we're trying to prepare you, okay, so that you can succeed, okay, that you can maybe have some things in your life worked out, mm-hmm. okay, to help you go on and succeed in what God has for you to do. And then, and we know, when you say that, we're not finding fault. I remember Reverend St. Clair did the same thing with me. And man, I told him I want to go to seminary, and we called it Bible college back then, and I believe God had me called. Man, it's like all the other brothers could be goofy and get away with everything. And he was just always kind of on my case. And one time I was feeling kind of bad about that, and he said, I'm fine-tuning. You're getting ready to leave. I'm fine-tuning. He said, you're called. God has you called. He has me dealing with you a little bit different. Okay. And not that we didn't goof around. We did, you know, at times, but he expected me to be more serious and be more mature than I had been when I first came to the service and so on. And it should be, we should grow, right? Yes. We should grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord. So we don't have anything personal against anybody, but God is preparing us for what he wants us to do. Okay. And it's a lifelong continual growth process. Okay. It never ends. It never changes. Thank God. And we can continue to grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord. Let's go to verse 6 now. Okay. Among whom you are also the called of Jesus Christ. Now he, you know, we've already kind of put the ball in our court, but he puts it there without any doubt. It's Paul's, I'm not just talking about me and the other apostles. Okay. It's not for Paul only, and not only for Peter and the other apostles and James and the others, but it was for anyone who is saved. Anyone who is saved is the called of Christ. We are called out of sin. We are called into a personal relationship with him. Jesus has called us to witness for him and to glorify him. Every Christian. Okay, there's no exceptions. Okay, every Christian. We are called to do that. So we go to verse 7 now. And I know we're moving kind of quickly. We want to get through our introduction and maybe get into some other things tonight. Verse 7, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So his salutation, his greeting. Okay, we are called to be saints in this life. We have grace and peace from the Father and from the Son. Now, what is grace? Grace is that favor of God. Okay, we have that. We always focus on the unmerited. Okay, well, we're children of God. Belongs to us now. We have the favor of God upon our lives. Not only do we have the favor of God, but we have that power of God working on our behalf. Okay, so we have grace and what? Peace from God the Father and from the Son. Okay, grace and peace, he said, to you. Okay, from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God. You know, that's a good greeting, isn't it? Amen?
Yes.
Grace and peace to you, brother. Okay? Well, thank God. I'll take it.
Yes.
Can you say that again? Can you give me some more of that? Okay, I'll take as much as you want to throw on me. As much. Go ahead and pray for me, and pray that God would give me grace and peace. We'll take it. Okay, and we all need it. Thank God for that, and we do have it. Okay, we just need to realize that we have it and learn to walk in it and not let things take that away from us. Okay, let's go to verse 8 now. Okay, first I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request, if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. So he commends their faith, and we see Paul's concern for them. I wonder where Timothy got that natural care that he had for the estate of people. No doubt he saw it in the Apostle Paul. Okay, he saw the way that he cared for these people, and he lets them know, okay, not only commending their faith, but he lets them know about his concern for them and that he's praying for them. That's a good thing to do. That's a good thing to let people know. You know, people need to hear that.
Yes.
You know, people that we work with, and people that we've invited, and people that have been to church before. People go through things just like you and I do. Mm-hmm. Okay? And some of them are not saved. Okay? They don't know how to look to God. And you're maybe the only godly person that they'll ever see or get in contact with throughout their days. And you come by their life and you let them know, hey, I'm praying for you. Okay? It can be like a boost. It can be like a shot in the arm. Okay? Encourage them. And maybe that's what they need to hear. Okay? To compel them, you know what? I really need to go back to church. Okay? To let people know that you're praying for them. This is what Paul was doing. Okay? And spoke of his desire to see them. Let's go to verse 11 now. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end that you may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was let hitherto or prevented, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. Now, Paul wasn't being lifted up in pride and all of this, but he knew his ministry. He knew what God had him doing, and he knew that he could spiritually be a blessing to them. Okay? Now, let's bring this to where we are. Now, it's not too much of an issue, but sometimes people start coming and, hey, come to the home. Hey, come and fellowship. Hey, come to Bible study. Hey, come to church. And they're like, I'm saved. I'm a Christian. Why do they always want me to come around? Because I know they're not trying to impart a spiritual gift to you in downtown Oceanside.
Yes.
Or in the barracks.
Right.
Are you here?
Yes.
Okay, that's not pride or anything like that. But we know that if you come to church, that we're going to, even if we're just playing a game or having a dinner, mm-hmm. Okay, you're going to experience love. Mm-hmm. You may learn something. You may be encouraged. You may walk in the door and somebody may say to you, man, it's good to see you.
Yes.
Huh? Does that ever make you feel good? Made me feel good when I was in the home.
Yeah.
I'd come walking in, hey, Brother Paul, how's it going? Good to see you. Like, praise God. Sometimes it just wiped the battle away. Man, you're at work and people are acting stupid and cursing God and mocking you because you're a Christian. Then you come around a group of people that love you and are like-minded and love God. Mm-hmm. And it's an encouragement. Okay? Well, Paul wanted to impart a blessing to them. He wanted to minister to them to help them to be established for them, okay, for them, and it would also be a comfort to him.
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
Okay, now it's a blessing to people when they come and they experience the love of God, they experience, that fellowship and so forth. Come on now. Now, if you're on the other end and you're the one that has invited this person, is it a blessing to you when they come?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, it is. Huh? Mm-hmm. I see people get excited. Praise God, so-and-so's coming to church tonight.
Yes.
Huh? Not only they're getting blessed, you're getting blessed too.
Yes.
And this is what Paul was saying. It's not only a blessing for you. I want to come see you and impart a spiritual blessing to you, but it's going to be a blessing for me too.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So this is what he's telling them. Okay? He wanted to be a blessing to them. It would be a blessing to him. Okay? They would both be comforted by their mutual faith. Okay? He would have to, he wanted to them to be established and have spiritual fruit. Okay? But he had been hindered from going there up to this point. Okay? So he was, he also in this was refuting the lies of the devil. Okay? Oh, he said he was going to come. He didn't come. He don't care about us. How come he don't come and see us? They didn't. Now, they couldn't say this back then. But what about, hey, that he didn't text me back. He didn't call me. Okay? Hey, I was just, I couldn't get there. I was thinking about you. I was going to call you, but something happened. Or text you, but something happened. But I just want to let you know I'm thinking about you.
Yes.
Okay? Now, I'm trying to bring it to where we can relate to it. Okay, in our lives. And it's a blessing. You let somebody know that you're praying for them. You're thinking about them. Okay? And you know, that can absolutely make somebody's day. That can pull them out of a battle. Okay, let's go to verse 14 now. Okay? This, he doesn't want them, be weak. He wants them to be strengthened. Verse 14 and 15. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as it is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also. Okay. So he wanted to have fruit among them. He owed it to people to share the gospel with them, not only the Jews, but also the Gentiles. And he was ready to preach the gospel to them that were in Rome also. Okay, now we need to be ready.
Yes.
The Bible tells us to always be ready to give an answer of the hope that is lies within us, doesn't it?
So,
okay, we got some ministers in here, some wannabe ministers in here. Okay, somebody gives you the opportunity to preach. Huh? Get up and preach. Huh? Share Jesus with somebody. Okay? Doesn't have to be some complicated thing. Then you get up and share your testimony. Sometimes that's the biggest blessing of all. Okay, we need to be ready. We need to keep ourselves ready to give an answer to people, okay? And we can do that, thank God. Okay, so we are debtors. We have an obligation to preach to people, okay? To the educated, the uneducated, the civilized, and the uncivilized. That's where he's talking about barbarians and so forth. Civilized and uncivilized. In other words, the whole world. The whole world needs to hear the gospel. We're going to go on here in just a moment, and we're going to start learning that the whole world lies in sin. There's no exceptions. Okay, therefore, the whole world needs the gospel. Jew or Gentile, anyone. Okay, they all need it. And we need to be ready to let people know. You know, somebody, you meet somebody or somebody at work, you have the opportunity to talk to them. And, you know, we shouldn't have to, hold on a second. Pastor, this guy wants me to talk to him about getting saved. What should I say? How did you get saved? You ain't getting, what if you can't get a hold of somebody? Get a hold of God.
Yes.
Huh? You ought to be ready to tell somebody about the Lord. Okay? So he's ready to tell everyone. Okay? And them that are in Rome also. Verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel. Okay? You don't have to be ashamed. Why do we have to be ashamed of what's right? What's truth? What's the only way to be saved? Well, they don't believe in my religion. We don't have a religion.
Right.
We have salvation. It's the only salvation that there is.
Yes.
Okay? That's the words of the Lord.
Yes.
Okay? You don't have to be ashamed because a lot of people don't believe it. They're all wrong. Those that don't believe it, you're not wrong because there's more of them. They're all wrong. Let every man, okay, let God be true and every man a liar. Okay? They're all wrong. Okay, don't be ashamed. Okay, verse 16. We are not ashamed. Okay, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein, in the gospel, is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Okay? So we're not to be ashamed of the gospel. Sometimes people will witness, to maybe someone who they're not intimidated by, maybe somebody that's poor, or, you know, somebody, people have this idea that certain people, they need to hear the gospel more than other people. Everybody without Christ is lost.
It's true.
Okay, whether they're some guy in the barracks who's maybe thinking about suicide, or some doctor. Mm-hmm. Okay, now we just went to Santee Lakes not too long ago, and we heard a bunch of sirens and stuff, and a bunch of emergency vehicles. Come to find out later on, while we were there, that was a response to an airplane that crashed probably 2 or 3 blocks from those lakes. Okay, a doctor, probably very wealthy, had his own airplane, crashed that aircraft and died. And it was a man driving a UPS truck. That plane hit his UPS truck and killed him. Okay, so you have some guy, probably very wealthy, maybe involved in society, some other guy, just a blue collar working guy out trying to make some money to take care of his family, driving a truck, delivering packages. Both of them went out into eternity.
Yes.
They both mattered. Okay. So we're not ashamed of it. We need to realize that not only does the person maybe that I'm more comfortable with, and who maybe is along the same educational background that I am, not only does he need God, not only does my fellow Marine need God, but you know, my first sergeant needs God. The colonel needs God. People that you meet, business people, wealthy people, educated people, everyone needs the Lord. Let's not limit ourselves and be afraid to speak to other people. Okay, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of it. I'll preach to the Jews in Jerusalem who should know about God, and I'll preach the promise of the Messiah. But the Romans and the Greeks who were brought up in Hellenistic beliefs, I'm not going to be afraid of them. They need the gospel also. Mm-hmm. And the gospel is the power of God that to save people, to everyone. Okay, it's God's righteousness. It's revealed by having faith in, and in it, we are justified. Okay? When we have faith, brother and sister, in that gospel of God, we put our faith in what God has done.
Yes.
Okay? In his death, burial, and resurrection, what he did when he died for our sins upon the cross. Brother and sister, that good news of a Savior who came and gave his sinless life, the Son of God on the cross for you and I put my faith in that. I've asked God to forgive me. I trust that he has. Okay? We're justified.
Yes.
But not only us, it's for every human being. It's for everyone. Okay? Again, we're going into verse 18 now. It's for everyone because everyone needs it. There's no exception. Somebody being moral and rich and having a high position, that doesn't mean that they're not a sinner. Okay? Any more than somebody that lives on the street and does drugs, they're not more of a sinner than that rich person. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. So let's go there. Now we're in section 2. If you look at your outline, we've gone from our introduction, okay, in chapter 1, verse 1 through 17. Now we're dealing with condemnation and sin. Okay, and I believe that word condemnation is on your definitions. Okay, so condemnation and sin, chapter 1, beginning in verse 18, and we'll go through chapter 3, verse 20. So let's go now to verse 18. Okay, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Unrighteousness. Now, what men? Who? All men. That's right. All men. All people, okay, hold. Well, they live over in China. And all of mankind has known about God from the very beginning. Okay? Did Adam and Eve know about God?
Yes, sir.
Yes, they did. Did their children?
Yes, sir.
Okay? And people got away from God and sin came into the human race through Adam and Eve. And people got away from God, but they knew about God from the very beginning. Okay, well, what about after the flood? Did those old eight people know about God? Yes, they did. Okay, all people, okay, are without excuse. Okay, and they hold the truth. In other words, they have the truth in the midst of all this unrighteousness. Mankind has the truth.
Yes.
And it didn't start with us.
Right.
Okay. They've had the truth from the very beginning. Okay. And we'll get into this, but that's where he's going with this. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and righteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. So he's telling us here, okay, that all need to hear the gospel because all are under the wrath of God. The Gentiles need to hear the gospel too. Okay, as well as the Jews. It's not just for the Jews. It's for everyone. They are condemned for their unrighteousness. Therefore, they, as the Jews, need a Savior. Everyone needs a Savior. Let's go on now to verse 19. Okay, we're going to verse 19. Okay. In verse 18, we could also say that not only is God's grace revealed in the gospel, but his wrath against sin is also revealed. Okay, the good news that a Savior was sent because we need a Savior, because we're all guilty and God will judge sin. If God doesn't judge sin, he's not righteous. Okay, but God is righteous and God did judge sin already. He judged it in his Son, Jesus Christ. If we'll accept that on God's terms, okay, we repent of our sin and allow him to be the Lord and the Savior of our life. So man has the truth. Okay, and even beyond, maybe somebody has not heard the actual gospel message, and that's not God's fault, okay? But we all have a conscience, brother and sister, and people suppress that conscience. John 3 and 19, and this is the condemnation that light is coming to the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. Let's go to verse 19 now, okay, chapter 1, verse 19, okay? So he talks about the wrath of God. Okay, there in verse 18 and how it's revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. He goes on, he tells us in verse 19, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them.
Yes.
You know, people who you say this cockamamie excuse, well, I don't believe in God. They are lying. They're lying. Okay, they may try to convince themselves of that, but if they get mad, why do they curse the name of the Lord or God, the Father?
Right.
They're not cursing Darwin. Mm-hmm. You ever heard anybody curse Darwin? Mm-hmm. Huh? Pastor, that's kind of silly. Well, stop and think about it.
Yes.
Everything that they say they believe in, when they lose it, when they get mad, who do they curse? They curse God. Mm-hmm. I heard of an aircraft that was going down and they had the voice recorder on back in the day when they didn't have doors, okay, to the cockpit. And they record what the pilot says and you could hear other voices in the background because people were screaming and yelling. This aircraft was going down. There were people on that aircraft that were praying and there were people on that aircraft that were cursing God. That's all you heard. It was either one
yes.
or the other. Okay? We inherently know. Somebody told me about someone who got stoned out of their gourd And then they said, well, I believe there's something greater. Well, there is. But it's not some hallucinating that you're doing. Okay? It's not some drug-induced visions that you're having. There is something greater.
Yes.
And I believe that we all know that.
Yes.
Okay? But it goes with John chapter 3 and verse 19. You know, mankind does not want to let go of their sin. Okay? That which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse.
Yes.
Okay? We have the witness of God's creation. Within every one of us, there is a knowledge of God. God has shown us by creation that he exists, even though we can't see him. Okay? We should understand that he is God and has all power, and there is no excuse. We are not ignorant of his existence. Now, okay, we were not Christian people growing up. But I remember being in elementary school. They started trying to teach us this garbage, maybe fourth grade or third grade, that we evolved. And there I am, a little knothead kid. My teacher was trying to teach me this stuff, and I said, no, we didn't. That's not right. I said, we didn't come from monkeys. We didn't come from some amoebas. I said, God made us. And we were not religious people, but I was a kid. That's why the Bible talks about childlike faith. Okay, now I didn't let that God denier change my mind. And I was a little sinner all the way up to the day I got saved. There's no doubt in my mind. I knew I was a sinner, but I still believed there was a God. Are you here?
Yes.
I knew there was a God. I mean, I may have been a sinner, but I wasn't in denial about truth. I knew there was a God. And it wasn't because somebody forced me to believe in it. Okay, I inherently knew that there's a God. I'd heard just a little bit about Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, just as he does with every other human being, he rang, because the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God bears witness of the truth. He tries to do that with people. Some people deny it and push it away. It's still the truth.
Yes.
And that's what they do. They push it away. It doesn't change it. Well, that truth was in my mind. I knew that there was a God. Okay, I wasn't going to say that we came from some kind of amoeba or evolved from monkeys. And so I got in trouble. They put me in the corner. Okay, made me go sit in the corner. Okay, still didn't change the fact that there's a God. Okay, we're not ignorant of God's existence. And what are you trying to say by all of that? I think a lot of you can relate to that.
Right.
You knew when you were a child, somehow you heard about God, maybe just a little bit, and you knew that's right. Because God told you that it was right by his Spirit. I mean, you heard an audible voice. That's right. But you knew in your heart it rang true. Okay, that's what God does. And he not only does, that's why people, brothers and sisters, people that live in foreign countries where they don't even have the gospel, like China or North Korea, somebody can go over there and preach to them, tell them about Jesus, and people will get saved. Because the Spirit of God in them bears witness that that's true. Or the Spirit of God deals with them and bears witness that it's true.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And this is what God has done. Man has known from the very beginning that God created man. Are you kidding me? Man, go outside in a beautiful day tomorrow and watch a hummingbird fly around.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? They wish they had helicopters that could do that. All these billions and billions of dollars for one, or millions of dollars for one, hundreds of millions of dollars. They can't go backwards. They wish they had one like that. Huh? All the parts they would have to get together and that thing would probably be massive. God's got this little old thing about that big that does it with ease.
Yes.
Are you kidding me?
Huh? The junkyard blew up. I got a brand new Mercedes sitting out in the driveway. All the parts just fell together. Huh? It drives itself. It's got all the newest technology. I can go down the road. I can let my hand off the wheel, put it on cruise control. It'll stay in the lane. Huh? That's about that. It ain't gonna happen that way. Huh? And neither did all this stuff that God created, even though man sinned. And we're living in a creation that is under a curse.
Right.
And it groans to be delivered from it. But it's still very majestic. Yeah. And we can't even figure it out.
Right.
We're so smart. We came from a Big Bang. You got a cold? I don't know what to do about that. Here, this will keep you from having a runny nose. No, we can't cure that. God can.
Yes.
Huh? Man is so smart, though. He's going to go on here a little bit. He's going to tell us that man professes themselves to be wise. And we can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 also. Professing themselves to be wise, they become fools. We deny God, we're a fool. Pastor, you're going to make people mad. Well, you got to face facts, you know. Can't deny God. What time is it anyway? I'm way over time. I'm sorry. I'm running my mouth up here. Okay, so we're there in verse 20. Okay, mankind is without excuse.
Yes.
Okay, so people tell you, well, what if somebody's never heard? Is that God's fault? They heard from the very beginning. Huh? They saw God face to face. God walked with them. Who denied who? Who pushed who away? Mankind pushed God away. Mankind wouldn't believe God and disobeyed him. Not only Adam and Eve, we've all done. We've sinned. Mm-hmm. Who is it that came along and made a way for us to be forgiven and to be saved? It was God.
Yes.
So mankind has no excuse. We're going to stop right there. God loves you. Okay, we love you. We got to face the truth, okay? God is real. Jesus came to save mankind from sin. Yeah, all of this garbage that goes on in this world and in people's lives, God doesn't want to be that way. God doesn't want you heartbroken. He doesn't want you defeated. He doesn't want sin to have dominion over you. God doesn't want all these bad things in your life. Jesus loves you. God loves you. He died to make a way by the sacrifice of his own life that you and I and anyone else who will receive it can be forgiven of all of their sin. If you'll pray and simply ask him to forgive you, come into your heart, believe it, open your heart to him. He'll come in right now, tonight, as we're here finishing up this Bible study. He'll wash that past away, and you'll know as he comes into your life that he is real. God bless you tonight is our prayer. We're going to end our Bible study right there. Lord willing, next Tuesday. Living in the past. Okay, next Tuesday. Your Bible study's on Tuesday now. Okay, 7:30, we will begin in around verse 20, 21. And continue on in Romans chapter 1. God bless you is our prayer. Let's go ahead and dismiss the Bible study. And Reverend Rossi, you dismiss us, please.
Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the wonderful opportunity to learn from your word. We thank you, Jesus, that it's because of you that we can be saved. We ask you, Lord, to help us to continue to just feast on the things that were shared this evening, to continue to seek you.